is Sky Gilbert, and I'm here to tell you about my book, Shakespeare Beyond Science, When Poetry Was the World. This book has just been published, and it will be released and on Amazon in September. I'm very proud of it, and I think it has great relevance to the whole Oxfordian position, and has lots to say to us as Oxfordians. Okay, so I'm going to tell you a little bit about my book. I'm going to, first of all, say that the book is about Shakespeare's rhetoric. It's a book which defines Shakespeare as a rhetorician primarily, which means an aesthete, which means someone who was in love with poetry and also to some degree was distrustful of it and even hated it, but loved it mostly, but both. It's very confusing, but it's all about rhetoric. And I suggest that, that is actually the subject matter of his plays, not moralism, not sort of what do we do, what's right or wrong, not instruction, but instead aesthetics, instead art. The subject of his work is art and poetry and its place in our lives. I'm going to talk about four people, Hermogenes, John Lilly, also David Garrick, and finally Petrus Ramus. And these four people are very important in terms of my book. John Lilly was Edward de Vere's secretary, and he is a writer credited with inventing the euphuistic style. The main thesis of my book is that Shakespeare wrote at a time when poetry was the world. Or what does this mean? It means that people learned about the world through poetry, not through examining it through a microscope, not through science. And this is because poetry and all rhetoric meant a mixture of style and content. In other words, there was no separation between what a poem said and how it was formed or what the style of that poem was. And I think Shakespeare believed that style and content were the same thing. The main stylistic element utilized by Shakespeare is paradox. And you, of course, can find this in The Witches and Macbeth when they say fair is foul and foul is fair. But it's constantly all over Shakespeare, everywhere. It seems he's incapable sometimes of mentioning anything without mentioning its opposite. And it's really easy, I think, to understand how style is content if you look at paradox. Because with paradox, you have a view of the world in which you believe that good and bad, you know, right and wrong, beautiful and ugly, all exist together in the world, and that we somehow have to accept that. And it isn't so much, and not judge it in a way, because paradox sets these two things constantly opposite, side by side, and yet says that's the way it kind of is. And it doesn't mean, of course, that we can't, you know, set up to right the wrongs or, but the work is not about that. The work is about just showing us the world in all its glory and all its fear and all its love and all its hate and all its beauty. And so the style of paradox, the stylistic element, paradox, is actually, has content. Paradox was the primary element used by Lilly, and it was also, as I say, the primary element used by Shakespeare. So I believe that Shakespeare may have written, and I'm not the only one who believes this, the early plays of John Lilly, because they seem to be kind of drafts of later Shakespeare plays, or that Lilly was in Shakespeare's inner circle, and that his style, his literary circle, his style, Lilly's style, euphuism, the overly ornate style, filled with paradox, became the Shakespeare style in later years, and that Lilly's writing was kind of a tryout for that. And the reason why I mention Lilly is because it accentuates the paradoxical elements in Shakespeare's work to compare his work to Lilly's. I also want to talk about Hermogenes. Hermogenes was a Greek rhetorician who did most of his work from 161 to 180 AD. I believe that Johannes Sturm was Shakespeare's teacher. And Johannes Sturm, because we know that de Vere, for instance, visited Johannes Sturm, who was a great educator in Germany. And Sturm's expertise was in the area of Hermogenes. And Hermogenes was a Neoplatonist. He was a, which means basically a very mystical, poet and a stylist who wrote about in the context of beauty and love. That's what Neoplatonism is the equation of beauty and love and truth. So Hermogenes was a Greek rhetorician taught by Sturm. De Vere went to Germany to take classes or to visit Sturm, we know that. And I'm almost 100% certain that he learned about Hermogenes there and incorporated Hermogenes' teachings. Now, Hermogenes is significant because he's very different than Cicero. And Cicero is who we usually associate, the rhetorician. He's a Greek rhetorician we usually associate with Shakespeare. And for Cicero, there were just three styles. The grand and the, I think the regular and then the low style. And you use them separately. So you were either writing a tragedy in the grand style or you're writing a comedy in the low style. And we all know that with Shakespeare's work, it's very different. Shakespeare's work is filled with contrasting styles. Now, Hermogenes believed there are not just three styles of writing, but 21 styles. There's one style called solemnity, one style called asperity, and there's one style just called clarity. And the final of his 21 styles was actually a combination of all of the styles. And that's what he believed the ideal style was that you were constantly shifting from one style to another within one speech, of course, within one play, within one poem. And this is actually the most characteristic thing, I think, about Shakespeare's style, is that it is not only the use of paradox, but the fact that it is constantly shifting. For instance, Hamlet's famous speech, to be or not to be, starts out with clarity, with a very clear statement, to be or not to be, that is the question. And then it jumps to solemnity, or grandeur, I think it is, when he talks about, you know, the sea, slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. So Shakespeare, this was uncommon. This was not the way writers wrote at that time. They decided on one style and stuck to it, and there were only three. Instead, Shakespeare uses many, many styles right up against each other, and suddenly a character's colloquial is speaking in slang or in a very immediate way, and then suddenly speaking in dense metaphorical poetry. And I think that Shakespeare learned this from Hermogenes. The other very important person we need to talk about is Petrus Ramus. He was the philosopher who destroyed rhetoric. That's why I don't like him. But anyway, he's not famous because he wasn't a very good philosopher. His teachings were his books are just not very good. They're not as good as Isaac Newton, let's say. But Ramus was one of the first scientists, and what he suggested was is that rhetoric was before that the way we learned about the world. In other words, we learned about the world through poetry. What Ramus said was, well, look at a poem. He was like a bad English teacher. He said, look at a poem and divide it between its style and its content. They're two separate things. And we don't care about the style. The style is frippery. It's adornment. It's been added there. It's actually kind of dangerous and kind of deceiving. And instead, what we have to do is we have to look at what does it say? And what is the moral idea? And what is the syllogism? In other words, what is the logic of the poem? What is it saying? What's its message? And that would be the way he'd analyze poetry. And that is the way he thought art should be and rhetoric should be. It should not be this world of paradoxes and many different shifting styles, and style and content are the same thing. It should be a clear message with the content separated from the style, which was not important. So in this way, Ramus basically destroyed rhetoric. It never was what it was after that. Dialectics took over. There were three parts of the classical trivium: dialectics, grammar, and the classical trivium was the curriculum in the Renaissance time. And the three parts were grammar and rhetoric and dialectics. And basically what happens is Ramus said dialectics should be in charge. That's the most important element. And rhetoric should be pushed aside, and we should be very suspicious of double meanings and puns and paradoxes and lack of clarity in style. And I would say that probably Shakespeare's singular characteristic as a stylist is his lack of clarity. And by that, I don't mean, of course, he doesn't communicate. He communicates beautifully, but he communicates very densely. And also many of his images seem to have many meanings or many associations or many resonances. And this was, Ramus didn't like this kind of language. And he was backed up by the Royal Society, which was a English society which formed in 1660. It was devoted to experimentation. And one of the most early scientific organizations, Isaac Newton eventually was a member. And the Royal Society did not like puns. They policed language. They did not like double meanings. And they did not like essentially what I would say Shakespeare's poetry was all about. And they didn't speak against Shakespeare, but they spoke against a certain kind of language, which they considered to be imprecise and not scientific. The final person I'm going to talk about is David Garrick. David Garrick is known as the Bardolator, which means that he made an icon of Shakespeare. This was around 1760. He was a director and a performer, and he had a huge jubilee where he celebrated Shakespeare. And he was really the first person to popularize Shakespeare, or one of the very first, about 150 years after his death. And suddenly, the reason we could love Shakespeare so much was because he was a good man and a moral man. And his plays had messages, and those messages were to improve us and make us better people. So he had to rewrite Shakespeare's plays, because Shakespeare's plays, I believe, they're just not these kind of, you know, clear moral messages. They're much more complex than that. And so he had to, for instance, rewrite Macbeth. And Macbeth has a wonderful death in Garrick's version, where he's being pulled down to hell and, oh, don't take me. I don't want to go. I've been evil. I've been bad. I'm being punished. All this stuff, which, of course, Shakespeare would never write anything like that. In fact, Macbeth seems a little bit more interested in his own imagination and in the dangers, and the play seems more, I think, more interested in the dangers of the imagination than it is in morality or in Christian morality. So, you had a sort of a misrepresentation of Shakespeare, which was the way that Shakespeare became popular in 1760, and with David Garrick. And also Garrick hated puns and hated double meanings, interestingly enough. So he cleansed Shakespeare's plays of this kind of this language, which was suspicious and complex and had many resonances. So that all that's very interesting, I think. And I really think that what we need to do is look at Shakespeare as an aesthete, as a rhetorician, as someone who created other worlds that he thought were more real than reality, and more important, and were perhaps reality in another way. It's hard to talk or think about this because it's another way of looking at the world that's from another era. But